This is Joe Wong. Welcome to The Trap Set. During the age of social distancing, we're recording remotely and releasing extra episodes. We've taken the past few weeks off to leave room for important social dialogue. Today's guest is Lenny White. Lenny possesses a deep groove which perfectly balances brash muscularity with nuance. He first attracted international renown for his performance on Miles Davis's paradigm-shifting 1969 album, Bitches Brew. Lenny has worked with several other luminaries, including Joe Henderson, Freddie Hubbard, Curtis Fuller, Don Cherry, Jaco Pastorius, Wallace Roney, and Buster Williams. Beginning in 1973, White began a highly influential tenure as drummer for the Chick Corea-led band Return to Forever. He's also worked as a producer for artists such as Chaka Khan and has recorded 16 solo albums. And now my conversation with one of the all-time greats, Lenny White. Hey, Lenny.
How you doing?
Good. How are you?
Good.
How do you feel about the unique state of the world right now?
Well, the pandemic is something that I've not witnessed before. The uprising I have. I mean, you know, I've seen this happen many, many times. But this is different because it's hinged with the pandemic, and you know, people have been inside and, you know, really don't get an opportunity to get outside, so this is a great opportunity to get outside, you know. But I've seen this happen before.
Are you finding that the pandemic is affecting your relationship to creativity?
Well, of course, because of the fact what the pandemic has done is it's taken one of the most natural things that humans do away. Humans congregate for everything. We congregate when we dissent. We congregate when we worship. We congregate when we want to watch great sports. We congregate when we want to watch and experience virtuosity when it comes to art. And we share opinions about art. And we give great energy to the artist. The artists give great energy to us. So without that, there's no art. I mean, it's not the same when you do it on a over the internet. It's not the same.
Yeah, I mean, I think of all the art forms, you know, music is an inherently social art form.
Yeah, you have to be there. You have to be there to experience, because what an artist does, an artist gives energy when they perform, and the audience reciprocates with their energy, and it causes this great relationship, and that's why you get great performances.
What I'm finding is that I think I took for granted how much everyday human interaction inspired my art, because I work as a composer for film and TV, and I write songs too. And I'm still working, but I just feel less inspired than I usually do. And I think it's because I'm just not coming into contact with other people.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, like, it's obvious. I mean, you know, there's, as I said, there's a certain energy that happens when it could be negative energy, it could be positive energy, but it's energy. And without that content between human beings, you can't feel that.
So you were born in Queens, right?
Yes, sir.
Did you grow up in Queens?
Yes, I did. Yep.
Which neighborhood?
Jamaica.
What was the neighborhood like when you were growing up?
Well, the area that I grew up in, it was a segregated area, and my family was the first black family to move into that area. I went to a black elementary school. Teachers, not all teachers, but a lot of the teachers were white, but most of the students were black students. So, I mean, I didn't really change until I went to high school. That changed for me when I went to high school, where I had an integrated high school.
What business were your parents in?
My mom worked, you know, at regular jobs at toy factories, and my dad was a truck driver, and then he was a car salesman.
Were they particularly musical people?
Extremely musical people. That's how I really got my musical landscape. The music that they played in the house was really great music. My musical soundtrack, I mean, between Lester Young and Count Basie, Duke Ellington, Red Charles, Miles, Train, you know, that's the music that was played around my house. And then I grew up listening to transistor radio, listening to, you know, soul music on the radio. And then I was a strange kid because I liked Broadway tunes. So when my parents were not playing jazz music, I was listening to Broadway tunes and the radio.
Like actual cast recordings, that kind of thing?
Yeah. I learned a lot of standard tunes by listening to, you know, soundtrack recordings.
Did you go to shows?
No. I didn't go to shows. couldn't really afford to go to Broadway shows.
I learned all those tunes because I was a waiter and they played it in the restaurant. So then when I would go play
that's
gigs,
a good one.
You know what I mean?
That's great. Yeah,
you know, I just knew.
You know, it's an interesting thing, though. I tell this to my students. You know, if you really want to learn these tunes, these standard tunes that has become jazz repertoire, you need to listen to the original version with the lyrics, because then you will understand the intent that the composer had for writing the song. And when you play the song, you should play it that way.
Yeah, and lots of the original versions also have verses that people throw out when they play it
of
as
course,
a standard.
Right.
But sometimes someone's slick and slips in the verse, you know?
Yeah.
So when did you start playing?
I was about 14.
Had you played another 14. Instrument before you gravitated to drums?
No, they tried to do that when I went to school and tried to join the band in junior high school. They wanted, the thing was, if you're going to play drums, you had to have had 2 years experience. I lied and told them that I had 2 years experience. But I actually did. They were going to make me play tuba. I said, no.
What was it about drums that appealed to you?
I don't know, really, because trumpet really appealed to me. And, you know, I don't know what happened with the drums, but, like, you know, the drums became something that was interesting. And I've probably had more exposure like that, you know, watching TV and seeing, you know, drummers on TV, which was kind of nice. And it looked like, wow, it could be really hip to play drums.
Did you have any friends in the neighborhood that played or any mentors?
No, actually, my dad was a real good friend with a saxophone player by the name of Sil Austin. We had some minor hits back in the late 50s and 60s. And he also did some leading of the pit orchestra at the Apollo, so I would get to be able to go to some shows and see him. And, you know, like, I got to meet the drummer that was in his band. And the drummer in his band was a drummer by the name of Majid Shabazz. And he had this beautiful red sparkle Gretsch drum kit.
Hmm. So that must have made an impression on you, if you remember the color of the kit.
Very much so. It's great. Right.
Well, it's interesting. So if you started playing when you were about 14, and then by the time you were about 20, you were already playing with Miles.
19, yeah.
Yeah, 19. So basically 5 years from the time you started playing. I'm guessing that you found that you had an aptitude for it right away?
Well, I was on a mission. I mean, no, I loved playing. And, you know, my dad encouraged it. Both my mom and dad encouraged it. And, you know, of course they play these records all around. And I didn't have a drum kit. And when I went to school, I played the school drum kit. And then my dad got me a drum kit. My first drum kit was a Kent drum kit. And it was, you know, it was almost a real drum kit, but not really. And, you know, I got really, really into it. And then it was a friend of ours, a friend of my dad's, who was really into music, because what they used to do is they, every Sunday, because we had a good record player, this is before stereos, and we had a really great record player. So my family and then friends of the family would come to our house, and they would fix food and sit around and listen to sides. That's what they call out, they call them sides. And they would debate whether Charlie Parker was cleaner than Sonny Stitt, or, you know, well, John Coltrane or Sonny Rollins, you know. And they would bring their records and have a contest to see whose records were. And I was a kid, you know, so, like, this is what was going on. And, like, you know, I absorbed all of that.
Did you start to develop your own taste outside of what your family was listening to?
Oh, well, of course. I mean, again, see, this is the time period where it's a very interesting point, because if you think about, like, the 50s, the music of the late 50s going in, I was born in 49, so I got the 50s and then into the 60s and the 70s. So, like, I've been listening to music quite some time and making music quite some time. So there were transitions. And, you know, I heard the transitions from what soul music was into what R&B became. And then there was the English so-called rock invasion. And so I wasn't musically myopic. I listened to all the music that I could listen to. And in the Broadway shows, they had orchestration. I listened to some classical music too. And, you know, rock and roll was starting to happen at the same time too. So I wasn't musically myopic. I listened to everything. I was kind of slanted because of the fact that, like, the music that was played in my house mostly was jazz music. So what happens is that you start to listen to all different kinds of music. And if you prefer a particular type of music, then that lens kind of focuses how you hear all music.
How did you meet Jackie Mclean?
I got a call, and I was supposed to show up at the Gold Lounge. I didn't drive. I was, you know, at my, so my dad, you know, would have to take me to the gig. And so after work, he drove me into Harlem, and I met Jackie Mclean by putting up my drums on the stage, and him turn around and say, "Bigfoot, one, two, one, two, three," and that's how I met him.
How did he know to call you?
There was, you know, I had started to play around town and sit in here and there with my dad. You know, he would take me to clubs and I would sit in. And so word of mouth got around and I got a call.
You said earlier that you were on a mission as a young person. When did that mission become defined in your mind?
Well, when I was 17, I heard a record by Miles Davis called Seven Steps to Heaven.
With Tony?
On the record, the drummer was 17 years old when he made it, and that was Tony Williams.
Yeah.
So immediately he became my guy to be able to be 17 years old and to play with Miles Davis, didn't he?
And of course, he played with Jackie before Miles, too.
Exactly. So he became my guy, and that became my mission.
So did you go out and meet him?
No, I had never met him, no. It was interesting because I got to play with Jackie, and before I played with Jackie, Jack DeJohnette played with Jackie. And so we played a gig at Slugs, and Jack came to the gig, and he sat in and played melodica while I played drums. So that was the first time I met Jack and the first time I had played with him. So now, the fact that I was young and I played with Jackie, and Tony was young, and he played with Jackie. And Jack was young and good. So, like, everybody said, "Oh, man, you play with Jackie. You're going to play with Miles next." You know, and so that's, as everybody was saying that, so this became a mission.
Do you still approach life in that same way? Like, do you lay out clear goals and execute a plan to achieve them?
Somewhat. But, you know, you make goals and then life happens, you know?
Yeah, but this is an instance where you had a mission and you actually accomplished it.
Yeah, that was true. That is true.
Was this an instance of you consciously manifesting an inner desire or following the cues of your life circumstances?
I think that when people understand their power, the power that they have, the, the powers that they're capable of, it does become a manifestation, something if you have an idea, ideal, and you say, you know, this is what I'd like to do with that ideal, and you say it, then you kind of get on a path and manifest that. And you will see that if you align yourself certain ways, you will bring that energy to you, and then you can achieve that goal. I mean, I listened to everything I could listen to. Tony Williams. You know, I listened to he was young when he was playing with Miles, so it wasn't that many things, but I listened to everything I could listen to. I listened to everything that he did, and I could hear before he played with Miles, so I could really get to that and understand, you know, what he brought to the music. You know, I'm kind of thorough from this perspective. If someone says, hey, I'd like for you to write some tango music, I have to go and I got to study tango so that I can be authentic.
Mm-hmm. What does it mean to you to be authentic?
It's truth. Authenticity is truth.
Where's the line between, imparting your own personal truth and respecting a tradition such as tango or jazz or whatever?
Well, you know, jazz music is a heritage. It's not a style of music for me. And the fact is, I was fortunate to be exposed to it and to learn it, to be mentored by people that were, I guess, pretty high up on the chain. And in doing that, I got an affinity for the representation, how it should be represented. And I tried to be as true to that as I could, because I learned it from those masters. I didn't just learn it from listening to records. I did that. I listened to records a lot. But then I met every one of the Magnificent Seven except Kenny Clarke.
Would you ask questions?
Of course. That's the only way. That we had a saying back in the hood is, you don't know, you better ask somebody.
Yeah.
So, If you didn't ask questions, you could not learn anything.
So for those that are listening and don't know what you're talking about, who are the Magnificent Seven?
Magnificent Seven are Kenny Clarke, Art Blakey, Max Roach, Billy Joe Jones, Elvin Jones, Roy Haynes, and Tony Williams. They are the architects of modern jazz drumming.
Were you mentored by any of them in particular?
Tony Williams. I mean, Tony wasn't the most... he didn't have a whole bunch of friends. He wasn't the most congenial guy. But, you know, in certain situations that I was in his presence, he was pretty cool. And he got me my first record. If it wasn't for him, I wouldn't have done Bitches Brew or Red Clay.
So how did you two meet?
Well, again, he had heard about me, and I didn't really meet him until later on. And he was pretty cool, you know? I mean, actually, he was working at Frank Capolito's drum center, drum shop here in Manhattan one day, and he was teaching there. And I came in there for something, and he saw me, and he said, come on upstairs. And he took me upstairs, and he said, you know, listen, this is when he was
not playing a lot because, you know, he had gotten to be pretty eclectic about the things that he wanted to do, rightfully so. And, you know, like, so people had kind of not been giving him calls. And he said, listen, you know, you could play and, you know, really keep a level head. And don't get a big head and don't, you know, because the music needs it. And, you know, that's the advice he basically gave.
When you were learning to play, did you consciously, you know, copy or learn how to quote other drummers? Like, for example, the Magnificent Seven? Would you transcribe solos, or how far would you take it?
Never, ever, ever. See, here's my point is that I'm a self-taught musician. And when it came to writing, transcribing is something that is beneficial for musicians. Don't get me wrong. But if you have to listen to something 50 times and transcribing it, if you don't have what it is that you're listening to under your grasp, after listening to it after 15 times, I don't know, you know, that you got to know that. You have to be able to identify, see what it is, hear the groupings, and be able to emulate that after listening to it, you know, 15 times.
Do you feel like by the time you were playing with Jackie that you had a clear creative voice?
No. I was still learning. I'm still learning. I mean, the fact is, Tony was my guy. You know, he was the guy that I heard. When I heard Tony, I mean, I had listened to all the drummers before that. They were all fantastic. But when I heard Tony, I heard all the drummers that had come before him. I heard him, and then I heard the future of where drumming was going, all in the same guy. Because I had never heard anybody play a five-stroke roll and not just play five strokes on the snare drum, but orchestrated through the whole drum kit. And he became an orchestrator when it came to playing drums. And so it was something that I hadn't really put together, that the music and playing drums like that is capable of, someone's capable of doing that. I mean, Max Roach, before that, had played, and he was an orchestrator also. But Tony did some things that I had never heard. It was outside of drum nomenclature. He added certain things to the drum lexicon.
Yeah, is that something that you seek to do consciously?
Oh, yeah. I always... Wallace Rundy was very close to Tony because, you know,
right,
he was in Tony's band. And I always said to Wallace, I said, I want to get inside Tony's head. I don't want to play like Tony. I want to know what he's playing and get inside his head. And the reason why he played that is what I want to get to, because I want to be able to have those same sensibilities and approach playing like that.
Were you able to do that? Do you think you got inside of his head?
To a certain degree. I mean, because of his approach. And, you know, I loved his approach. I loved his approach to playing music in general, because he's found different groupings than everybody else. And his way of playing the instrument is so unique to him I mean, that's why he's got a lot of emulators. But, I mean, it's so unique to him. The ride cymbal to everything that he did.
Yeah, I mean, I've spent weeks just trying to figure out how he tuned the way he tuned.
Well, yeah, I mean, he tunes. Well, he changed. He changed the way he tuned. Because when he played with Miles, it was a different kind of tuning than when he played after that, because the drums got big.
Mm-hmm.
And I heard him do a clinic, and he said that he really doesn't tune to any particular notes. He tunes so that, like, the drums have some differences. And it was that simple. I mean, you know, but I found the thing. I've always loved Max Roach's tune. Yeah. Max, Philly Joe, Elvin, you know, Art Blakey, all those guys, you know, like, they have their own particular way of tuning. But, I mean, and I found my own voice. I have a way that I tune, and in doing that and in playing that way, I find a lot of different things to play. It's like, I could kind of explain it. I don't know if this is a good explanation. But if you had a C melody saxophone and you played whatever you played in, you would have a specific, somewhat unique sound, because everything that you heard would be from the spectrum of the C melody saxophone. And so I have a tuning that I use. And when I play with, you know, different people, tuning gives me a different palette to play.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. Almost like setting up the parameters within which you can generate ideas.
Yeah. And so it's not just rhythmic ideas. But it's rhythmic ideas shaded by tones.
So you mentioned that Tony helped you get the gig on Bitches Brew.
I don't know if you know the whole story, but Tony had brought John McLaughlin to the United States to play in Lifetime.
Right.
And they did In a Silent Way. And Tony came to the studio and saw John McLaughlin there. And it was like, you know, Miles had heard John and called John to play on the record, and Tony had brought him to the United States. And so, like, there was a little rift there, and Tony said that he would never play with Miles, and he didn't. So Miles was going to do this new project, and he needed to have two drummers. I mean, Jack was playing with him at the time, and he wanted it to be Jack and Tony. But Tony said no, and he recommended me.
Do you remember getting the phone call?
Yes. Yes. It was pretty interesting. Because, you know, Miles with his raspy voice, he called my house, and my mom picked up the phone, and she said, you know, who's this? And he said, Miles. He said, you got to speak up, Miles. He said, well, I don't care who you are. If you don't speak up, I'm not, you know, answering the phone. And so we finally got to the point where, like, you know, said that it was Miles. He asked me to be at his house for a rehearsal. And we got to his house for a rehearsal.
How much direction did he give you?
Okay, so at the rehearsal, he told me to bring a snare drum and a cymbal. And Jack, Dave Holland, Chick, Wayne, and Miles. And all we rehearsed was the beginning of Bitches Brew. Do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do. That's all we rehearsed, and he said I'm going to be in the studio. And so I was there at 9:30, and seemingly let me in. I was setting up my stuff and everything like that. So I was setting up the jack, next jack, and you know, I was trying to get my drums sound good. And he came in, and over the loudspeaker into the control room, he said, "Hey, Jack, tell that young drummer to shut up." I was intimidated already. But the direction that he gave me, he said, "Listen, think of this as a big pot of stew, and I want you to be salt."
Hmm.
So, now what musical knowledge am I going to call upon for me to be salt? So, it went from the experience of playing music to creating music. So my first opportunity to be on a recording, I didn't play the music. I created the music. I learned how to play music later on. But in those first instances, I learned how to create music. It's a different perspective.
Yeah, I wonder if when we're young, we're more geared towards creating than playing.
Right, that's the whole point. See, most musicians are taught how to play music. So there's a page that's put in front of them, and they say, "This is what this is. This is the scale. This is the rhythm." Da, 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 da. And you do that, and you get very, very proficient at playing music. As a musician, you get very proficient at playing music. But then when you take the page away, and someone says, "Create." A lot of musicians have issues with that.
Right. It's almost as if you are learning to read before you're learning to talk.
Right. Or learning to understand what it is that you read.
Right. Or learning grammar and syntax before you're learning how to communicate, you know?
Exactly right. And so when you create for the very first time in front of people, that's exactly what you're doing, is communicating. You're finding out how to communicate. You're finding within yourself how well you can do that, how good you are at communicating.
When you hear that recording back, what does it make you feel?
Man, you know, when I did it, we did it 3 days, August 19th, 20th, and 21st. 24 hours after Jimi Hendrix hit the last note at Woodstock. And I did that record. No one knew what we were doing because there was nothing, there was no precedent for us to say, "Okay, this is what we're going to do, like that. We're going to do it like that." Because Miles was experimenting too. you know, I wound up on Miles Runs the Voodoo Down. You know, there's some outtakes you can see that Jack and I were like kind of getting into them. We thought we were playing some great stuff, but that wasn't what Miles wanted. He wanted something funky. So he said to me, "Man, you ain't getting the chicken." And so Don Elias, who was playing percussion, got on my drum kit and played like this really simple second line groove. Jack couldn't play it either. But Don played it, and then Jack played some stuff around it that worked. And I wound up playing percussion on that track. And I was kind of despondent afterwards because I said, "Wow, I had an opportunity to do this, and like I didn't, you know." And Miles said, "Oh, no. No, it was cool. Tomorrow we'll, you know, do something different." And, you know, it was okay. It was all right. Because he was experimenting too. So we didn't know what it was going to be. And I was the only one that actually heard the tracks before the record was released, because Miles called me and asked me to come over to his house. And we sat and listened to, you know, what we had done. And it sounded, I had never heard anything like that before. And after when the record actually came out, it sounded different too, because T.O. had taken the bridge out of one thing and put it in the front of something else. And he did a lot of editing to make it do something different. And so it was, we never heard anything like that. We had never heard any music like that before. So that was in August. In October, I woke up out of a dead sleep and said, "I recorded with Miles Davis." Wow. It took me that long to decipher what it was, because I was in a fog. But what I did know was that it was documented. And so for the rest of my life and for the rest of the life of any music, there was an actual documentation that I did play with Miles Davis on this particular landmark thing. And what can I say?
Then you went on the very next year to make another landmark album with Freddie Hubbard, Red Clay. How did that come about?
Well, how that came about is Freddie had called Ron Carter, Herbie Hancock, Joe Henderson, and Tony Williams to do that record. But with the rhythm section of Tony, Ron, and Herbie, they've been doing a bunch of records, and Miles was kind of miffed at them because he was paying them, a salary, and they were going out making everybody's records. So they made a little pact that they would not do that at that point. And so Tony recommended me to do that, to do the record. And that's how I got to do it. And Freddie called me and said, can you make a record date? And I said, yeah, sure. Who's on it? He said, Ron Carter, Herbie Hancock, and Phil Henderson. And I tried to sound really, really, you know, cool. Yeah, sure, sure, sure. But on the other end, I was going like, ah, going crazy. These guys are my heroes. Are you kidding? What? Oh.
And this is really only about 6 years after you picked up drumsticks for the first time.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
When you hear yourself on those records, do you feel like you had come into a voice by then?
No. No. I was getting it together. But, you know, see, sometimes the process or the path is what is really very, very interesting.
It's reductive for me to say that you arrive at a voice. I mean, it's something that you're constantly tuning, right?
Yeah. I mean, but see, there were things that I was working on that would be identifiable things. I didn't know at the time, but like, you know, when I heard Four and More and I listened to Tony Williams's ride cymbal, I was enamored by the clarity. And so what I did is I went into a corner of a room and just took the ride cymbal so that I could emulate what that was. Now, in doing that, Tony had an identifiable sound. In me trying to emulate what that was, I realized later on that would be something that would identify my sound. And so, you know, again, you never know when you first start to do this or to do that, that you do have a sound. Of course, when you play through someone else, you realize how supposedly close to that person that you want to emulate you sound like. But in essence, there are certain things that you do that only you do, or the way that you do that, the way that you hear that is identifiable with how you do it, even though you may think that you sound like this other musician. So sometimes it's better to play through somebody to find out who you are. Everybody else is taken. You can't be someone else. You can only be yourself. And so, again, no matter how close you think you sound to a particular other musician, there are going to be things that are intrinsic just to you, that you do it a certain way. And that's what makes you you.
Did you meet Chick on the Bitches Brew sessions?
Yeah, yeah. It was interesting because I met Chick in the Bitches Brew sessions, but there was a loft. It was a building on 19th Street where there were three lofts. And it was Chick Corea lived in one loft, and Dave Holland lived in the other, and Dave Liebman lived on the top loft. And so I've known Dave Liebman 17 years old, 16, 17. And we would go and play at Dave's loft all the time with Steve Grossman and Randy and Michael Brecker and Carl Schroeder,
George Cable, you know. And so, like, it's a thing. It's like this loft thing where we could all play and everything. So Chip was there, too. I mean, so I met him there, but we had, you know, interactions somewhat after that, too.
What was the impetus to join Return to Forever?
Well, what happened was I had played with Stanley, with Joe Henderson. Joe Henderson had asked me to be in his band after we did Red Clay. And so he needed a bass player. And one night I had gone to Slugs to hear Horace Silver. And it was this guy playing electric bass that was killing us. So when the set was over, I went up to him. I introduced myself. I said, here's Joe Henderson's number. Give him a call. He needs a bass player. We need a bass player for it. What are we going to make it do? And it was Stanley Clarke.
Mm.
And so we played together with Joe Henderson for about 18 months. You know, George Cable's and Stanley Clarke and myself for the rhythm section. And after that, I went and played with Freddie Hubbard. And Chick came and played with Joe Henderson for a while. And then Chick and Stanley went and played with Stan Getz, along with Tony Williams. And so after the Stan Getz configuration, they put together Return to Forever with Flora Purim and Ayerto and Joe Farrell. So by the time they had done that, they did Return to Forever and Light as a Feather. And they were in Japan. And I had left Freddie Hubbard, and I got a call to be in a band called Azteca.
With Pete Escovedo, right?
Pete and Coke Escovedo, right. And Paul Jackson, and Tom Harrell, Mel Martin.
Folks that don't know, that was a band on Elektra, and Pete, obviously, is Sheila E's father, and she actually played in that band for a bit too, but it was kind of in the wake of like what Santana was doing and kind of what Bitches Brew was doing. It was
Santana with horns. And it had four singers, four horn players, three keyboard players, percussion, two percussion players, and my drums. You know, I mean, it was a big band. I mean, if you read the book Hitman, Clive Davis talked about a band that he was introducing at midnight at the Grosvenor House Hotel for the CBS convention, and that was that band, Azteca. And so I had gone out to San Francisco to be a part of Azteca, and I got a call while I was out there from Chick from Japan. He said, listen, man, Stanley and I are coming to San Francisco to play a week at the Keystone Corner. Can you do it? I said, yeah, sure, I'm here. So we had a week at Keystone Corner that was remarkable. I actually have pics of that, just the trio. And on the Sunday, the last day of the gig, two guitar players sat in. Gary Finnerty and Billy Connors, who were both Bay Area players. I think Mel Martin might have said it. Mingo Lewis, who played with Santana. And so at the end of that gig, that night, Chick said, listen, I want to form an electric Return to Forever, and I'd like for you to be in the band. And I said, well, Chick, I'm out here with this band, Aztec, and I think I want to stay and be a part of that. Yeah, he said, okay, I understand. So they went back to New York, and Stevie Gadd played with them.
And I think this is about what, 4 or 5 months, because while I was out in San Francisco, a manager, Herbie Herbert, came to me and he said, listen, would you be interested in, you know, jamming with Ross Valerie and Neil Sean? I said, yeah, sure, I'm around. So we did some jamming. I have takes of that too. And it was great, you know. So Greg Raleigh, who was in Santana, was leaving Santana, and they were putting a band together. So they asked me to be a part of this band. But by this time, the chick had called me back, and he said, listen, man, why don't you come and you know, do this band with us? And I said, okay, yeah, I think I'm going to do that. So I left San Francisco and went back to play with Virginia. But the band that I was supposed to be a part of that we were starting up was Journey.
Any regrets?
Not really. No. I learned a lot about myself by playing with Return to Forever.
What did you learn about yourself?
You know, you have to be put in musical situations, or any life situations that are out of your comfort zone. And again, in playing in front of a whole bunch of people, you have to learn how to communicate, not just play. You got to learn how to communicate. You have to learn how to play something that will move a great number of people. And when you polish your abilities to do that, then you get a certain amount of respect. And I had to learn that.
Did you get into Scientology?
No. They tried to get me into Scientology, but it's a very good subject. It's a good subject.
Lots of people were getting into it back then.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
It was kind of riding in on the New Age movement that was happening around that time, too.
Right. I mean, you know, this, you're talking about, like, you know, maybe just a few summers removed from the Summer of Love, you know. It was going that way. Everything was going that way. People were finding new ways to express themselves and finding new ways to worship.
Do you practice a particular spiritual tradition now?
No. I've always been one who's been curious about things and taking a lot of information, and taking in a lot of information, try to maybe have a viewpoint that is, I don't know how to explain it. I really don't know how to explain what my viewpoint or feeling is about that, but there are a lot of different ways to worship, and I don't cast any problems on anybody and how they do that, you know. But I do believe that, yes, there is a supreme.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it seems like there's, you know, people have different ways of accessing that energy.
Right.
How do you approach making solo albums versus being a member of a band?
Oh, shit. It's just a solo perspective. I mean, you have a perspective that is yours. You choose music. You choose the style of music. You choose who you want to play the music. That's yours. That's different than being in a band. The dynamic of a band is a very powerful and interesting dynamic, because basically it's a microcosm. And, you know, there are four, five, six, however many the size of the band is, that has a consciousness that's a collective consciousness. And it goes out and it makes a statement. And the statement is a big statement, a major statement, that is a statement done by five or six individuals. When you go and out, excuse me, and do a solo album, that's your state.
I was thinking about the story you told about recording Miles Runs the Voodoo Down, and how you switched from drum kit to percussion, and you were kind of despondent, and Miles comforted you after that session. And I was thinking about how smart that is as a band leader, and how he was able to intuit that and then also protect your confidence so that you could show up the next day ready to play. And, you know, you've worked with lots of the best band leaders over your career, and I wonder how that informs your leadership style, or how you would describe your leadership style.
I learned a great deal from Miles. Miles gave me a certain amount of exposure for the first time ever. I mean, and Miles was a conceptualist. So you got, as I said earlier when we were speaking, Miles got me to create music. He didn't get me just to play music. He got me to create it. And so from that perspective, from day one, there it is, where I have this perspective that is, I have to create something as opposed to play it. So in trying to create something, what you do is you find individuals that can help you shape that creation. So you find certain people and you look for that in musicians. You said, wow, I like the way that guy plays this, and you include him. I like the way she does that, and you include her. And then you shape your vision along with them. You create that together because you have somebody else to play off of, and you help shape this new thing. It's like being an artist. If you say, okay, I want to have a blue sound, you get somebody that, excuse me, is a darker shade of blue along with the yellow that the other person has. And then, like, you create this thing, and it's blue, but it's like this shade of blue that is unique to what it is that you saw. And that's what Miles did with all the people that were in his band.
Right. And what's really powerful about that is by letting everybody in the band, welcoming them to create in the way in which they're naturally qualified to create.
Right. They didn't tell them what to play.
Right. Well, that's so much more powerful than telling somebody what to play. Because then they're...
I mean, listen, that's exactly right, man. You listen. So what? Two notes.
Right.
And look at what they did with that. Amazing. But that's the true genius of Miles, being able to pick the right musician to help him realize what he wanted to realize. He heard something different. And in trying to get it, he chose the right people to help him get that. And that's the same way that I do my music.
How did that extend to your approach as a producer when you started working with folks like Chaka Khan?
Well, that's a perfect example. I listened to Chaka, and, well, you know, we had worked together before. I mean, what happened was kind of interesting. We had a mutual friend. I was recording in L.A., and I had rented a house, and I was
rehearsing in the house. And this friend of mine brought Chaka to the house. And we were doing an arrangement on Lady Madonna. And she heard it and said, "Wow, man, that's great. I want to sing on that." And that's how we got to work together. I met her, like, when I was in Return to Forever, I was in North Carolina in an airport, and I was walking through the airport, and I hear somebody say, "Lenny White." And I said, "What?" And I turned around, and she said, "Chaka Khan, Rufus." That's how I met her.
Wow.
And then, so we worked together after that with, she was on my Streamline album. She did Lady Madonna, excuse me. And so she had done a bunch of records when she had left Rufus. And one of the records that she did, what was the Dizzy Gillespie tune? Night in Tunisia. And I thought that she did a great job on that. So in listening to that, I had gone to Bruce Lundvall and said, "Bruce, I have a great idea for a project." He said, "What is it?" I said, "I want to recreate the Lady Day session with contemporary musicians." He said, "Oh, who do you want to use?" I said, "I want to use Chaka Khan." And my idea was to get all my former employers, on the same record. I wanted Freddie Hubbard, Chick Corea, Joe Henderson, Jackie Mclean. But Jackie wasn't able to do it. So, you know, I had the other guys. And he said, well, if you can get them, sure, let's do that. And so I called Chaka up and I said, "Chaka, would you want to do a jazz record?" She said, "Me?" I said, "Yeah, I think it would be great." She said, "Well, who are you going to use?" I said, "I'm going to get Freddie Hubbard, Joe Henderson, and Chick Corea, and Stanley Clark." He said, "Well, if they'll do it, I'll do it." And everybody gave me the same. I called Freddie Hubbard up. I said, "Oh, you want to do this record with Chaka Khan?" "Chaka Khan? Well, she'll do it, I'll do it." And Chick, the same thing. And so that's what happened. You know, that's the way I put that together. You know, I'm a big movie fan. I'm a huge movie fan. And I make records like movies are made. I'm like the director of a movie. And the musicians are the actors. And, you know, I put together projects like that.
Right, and movies are so collaborative. They're probably the most collaborative format in the modern era.
Yep.
So that kind of speaks, again, to what you were saying before about letting people be themselves within the context of this project that you put together.
Yes.
What movies have you watched the most times in your lifetime?
Godfather.
Which one, one or two?
All three of them.
Really?
It's all one movie to me.
So many people swear off three.
Yeah, because they're not movie fans. I mean, the greatest scene in all three movies, well, I don't know. The Godfather 2 has one of the best scenes ever, too. But
which one would, between the boat scene?
Say it again?
Which one are you talking to about? Which scene are you referring
to? Godfather 2?
Yeah.
No, Godfather 2 when Michael tells Fredo that he knows that he's the one. That's a great scene, man. That's absolutely fantastic. And then scene in 3 when Michael finds out, Michael sees his daughter get shot.
Yeah.
Now, this is some movie trivia here now. The fact that what makes it so overwhelmingly great is the fact that there is no sound. That, like, you know, when you see him crying, screaming, but there's no sound. Now, I heard that was something that was done by the editor. There was sound there, but the fact is that it's so powerful
with you not hearing the sound, that's what makes that scene so great.
Mm. What do you think about the most throughout the day? Do you find your mind looping to recurring thoughts?
Music. I'm trying to write music every day. I mean, you know, the fact is, I had a compromising thing happen to my shoulder, so it's been difficult, somewhat compromising to play, but, you know, I've tried to practice. But now in this pandemic thing, not knowing when you're going to play again, what I've been trying to do is write music so that whatever the situation is, I still would have a voice of something that was done, like with me not just being idle, but I'm constantly trying to write music.
How's it going?
It's going. I mean, it's like anything. If you do it enough, what happens is you get a great deal of content. Not all of it is good, but, you know, you work at it, the better you get at it.
Yeah, it's like panning for gold.
Yeah.
You got to get lucky sometimes.
That's right.
I feel like it comes from outside of us in the same way that gold does, right? I mean, you can practice the discipline of, you know, panning for gold or fishing or whatever metaphor you want to use, but it's all about kind of, you know, interacting with the world and pulling something out of it.
That's right. That's basically goes back
then
around.
Then putting it back into the world.
Saying.
Yeah.
Right. It goes back to what it is that you're saying. You know, you have to have that contact with the world. And what's hard now in this pandemic is that we don't have that.
Yeah, at least not with other humans.
Right.
Well, do you have a specific mission in the same way you did when you were a teenager?
Yeah, you know, I've gotten in so many different situations where I've made great music with great musicians, and I've seen the effect that that has. Music has a very, very healing effect, and I've been many, many times in situations where I felt that power along with the other musicians that I've made it with. And when you experience that once or twice, it becomes a drug that you can't do without. And I want to continue to do that because the way I felt playing music and seeing the effect that that has on people, which is a positive effect, I want to continue to do that. And if I can't just play it, I can write some music that does that, has that same effect. That's my mission. My mission is to help change the perspective of the world with music, positive music.
You referred to playing music as like a drug, and when you do drugs, the potency or the high can diminish over time. Have you found that the high from playing with other musicians has ever diminished?
No. See, the point is, I might have phrased that the wrong way. It's not that playing the effect is what is the high. The music is something that I do. I mean, and if you do it enough to where I was consumed by the music, so the music is who I am. Playing drums is what I do. Mm-hmm. But the music is who I am. I can't go a day without listening to some music.
Do you play every day?
No, I try to write music.
Yeah.
You know it. You know, you do the same thing. You know it.
Yeah, I don't know. Well, I'm not, I'm trying not to be presumptuous, you know. Everybody's different. But what I will say is this, you know, to my point of feeling depleted by not being able to connect to other people, I was feeling depleted and kind of dull before this conversation. And I feel like the longer we've spoken, the more grounded I feel again. And I thank you for spending this time with me. And it's been very inspiring to speak with you. And your music has been a constant presence in my life for decades.
I thank you. That proves that my mission wasn't a failed mission.
Lenny White, thank you for being on the show.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Trap Set is produced by me, Joe Wong, along with Chris Karwowski, who also edits the program. Follow us on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook at The Trap Set, and visit our website, thetrapset.net, to subscribe to our show for free. If you enjoyed what you heard today, please donate to our show. If you can't afford to donate, please tell a friend and give us a good rating on iTunes. Send your feedback and guest requests to thetrapset@gmail.com.